Welcome to Downtown Variety, take 8 on May 8th at 8 p.m. It's the night of eights. I am Mattie Barber-Bockelman, your host. Thank you for joining us. This is La MaMa and CultureHub's online performance series exploring how we can collaborate and create and connect during this time. Downtown Variety has been our exercise. It's been our homework, discovering what we can do with this medium, with this emerging form. And so many artists have been a part of this process. Over 75 artists, actually. Many very familiar faces, many artists from La MaMa's family, and new artists, new friends, who it feels like we never really would have met without Downtown Variety. And this has felt like an exercise in collective visioning, artists sharing propositions of what could be possible online, what types of connections, emotional, intellectual, exploring liveness and presence on screen in a way that's different than TV and film. So this is a collective visioning for what life is going to be like going forward, because I've sort of been dreading how long this is going to go on for, but you know, it's not going to end magically anytime really soon. So let's see what we can do together. And we're experimenting using LiveLab, which is an experimental software that CultureHub has been developing for almost 5 years for networked collaboration between artists, audiences, and technologists. So here we are. Our first performance tonight is by Laura Sofía Pérez and Christopher Ryan Williams. And they're joining us from Brooklyn, New York. Very recently, they were in Los Angeles, but they've moved here. And what better time to be acclimating to New York City? So I'm Mattie, I'll be here. And you might have noticed, I've moved all the way from my bedroom to the living room. So this is big. I'm just settling in here. So welcome to the living room. Okay, so our first performance, Laura Sofía Pérez and Christopher Ryan Williams.
Be honest.
I know, right? You came here with the idea of
playing gigs every day and being outside and meeting with people and being exposed, and now kind of feels like we could be anywhere.
Yeah, I mean, coming from LA, it definitely feels very similar. This really surreal, kind of isolated existence that I'm forced to live. I'm curious to see if it continues past that point of no return, maybe we don't stay. I don't know.
Where would you go?
Somewhere with more wildlife, less people, something to explore. What about you?
It'd definitely be good to run in the woods. But I don't feel like anywhere would compare to New York. At the same time, I don't feel like anywhere is any different than here.
Anywhere is anywhere at this point. It's just what it is. Yeah, it's hard. I don't really have it.
Is there such thing as silence? Even if I get away from people, do I still have to listen to something? Say I'm off in the woods. Do I have to listen to a stream babbling? Is there always something to hear? If my head is full of harmony, melody, and rhythm, what happens to me when the telephone rings? To my peace and quiet, I mean. Are we getting anywhere asking questions? Where are we going? Is this the 28th question? Are there any important questions? How do you need to cautiously proceed in dualistic terms? Do I have two more questions? And now, do I have none?
All right, so that was Laura Sofía Pérez and Christopher Ryan Williams, who are going to join me in our interconnected living rooms in just a moment. We met Laura and Chris through Culture Hub in Los Angeles, and now they're here in New York. Hey, can you guys hear me? Hey. Oh yeah. Hey. Wow. So it's like a pretty calm. Oh yeah. Now the water's starting to boil. I see it steaming here in camera four.
I'm so sorry. Can you say that again?
Now I see the water starting to boil here in camera four.
I know, right?
Man,
just timed it just a little.
Okay, so you guys had four different cameras set up in your home, right?
I was just gonna say that we're in a friend's home who calls this place the new live revolution, I think it is. But it's a large space, so we were able to spread out.
Yeah. And when I met you in LiveLab just a few days ago, you were telling me how you were just starting to experiment with other video conferencing software, because with you and using the sort of built-in sound switching that they did. So how were you experimenting then, and how did you end up creating this piece now?
So it began with, we were having a lot of rehearsals and meetings via Zoom or Google Meet. And a lot of our meetings were about creative projects it was kind of inevitable to start thinking about ways of how to show work from our home with all of our different collaborators. And then I guess a lot of people are on the same boat, because then you reached out and you were doing a similar project. One of the things that we were trying out was the different settings that were sound sensitive. So, for instance, in Google Meet, we have this effect that's called Spotlight. And we started experimenting with how making different sounds in different rooms would focus into a particular camera view where the sound was coming from. And that kind of evolved into this.
I feel like we use Spotlight as a springboard to kind of create a little bit of a storyboard, and allow us to explore kind of space and how to travel around, and kind of travel when you're in a confined space.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Kind of give the illusion that maybe we have more space, or maybe we're right on top of each other.
Totally.
Yeah.
Man, I thought this was your home, and I was like, wow, you guys just moved in, and it looks amazing. I was so excited. It's nice. How does it feel being in New York right now? Because it's not familiar terrain for you, is it?
For Lauda, it is.
Oh, I didn't know.
I actually lived here for a really long time before I went to LA. I went to LA just to do my master's. But it's really different. We got here and we had a really great, 3 weeks where we were going out every day, meeting people, going to shows, things like that. Really got the ball rolling on some things that eventually all got canceled. Yeah. So it feels kind of temporary, really. I mean, so does everything. This is our second place we've had already since we moved here 3 months ago. So it's like, It's been feeling kind of difficult to settle.
Yeah. Well, I feel like I've, settled into your space with the pacing of this piece a little bit more too. So, and it feels like you guys are really starting to build on something with these multi-location but same location collaborations. So that's exciting.
Yeah, I think it's really fun.
I'm
excited to do some more experimenting. Thank you for letting us kind of push your LiveLab to the limit.
I know, because the truth here is that they're on iPhones, and we really didn't think that LiveLab was working on iPhones, but
fudged it.
Had it working sometimes, so
yeah.
Cool. All right. Well, thank you all so much for joining us, and I hope that we'll have you back sometime.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, it was a pleasure.
Good night.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So, people are collaborating with people in their homes, and a lot of our performers are sort of displacing people in their homes. And I would like to acknowledge the people that I have been displacing, but tonight they are in place. I have a lovely in-studio audience, and we haven't had the cocktail hour yet, but I will bring that to them shortly as a thank you message. So panning now to the in-studio audience, Leah and Simona, who are standing by. Shaky hands. I've got a cocktail napkin, just like they would be out. And I think you ordered a gin and tonic.
Yes,
is that
thank
true?
You so much.
Yes, a gin and tonic. Go right ahead. And you might recognize that hand, which was featured on Downtown Variety Takes 1-7, and that cocktail. And ma'am with the red wine, yes, whose tracksuit you may have recognized from Downtown Variety Take 6? I don't know. Give it up for Leah and Simona and whoever else you would like to give it up for in your own home. So now, panning back. All right, now we're waiting for, and I see Paul Lazar. Oh, hello, Paul. I'm turning my head so I can see you, but now you're upright for me.
Oh, okay.
All right. So what do you got?
Oh, shit. Oops. Okay.
Okay.
I'm
you got
ready.
Mark?
Yeah, I'm good.
All right. Well, what you gonna do?
Well, when you give me the go, I'm going to give a spiel about the cage piece, and then I'm going to get up and do a little of it. Then you and I are going to talk.
All right.
Does that sound right? Okay. Hello. Hi, everyone in the globe during the global you-know-what. A few years prior to this catastrophe in the 1960s, John Cage wrote, I guess I can scratch my nose on global television. anyway, Cage wrote 90 stories, and then he recorded them for a piece that he created called Indeterminacy. Anyway, when he recorded these stories, he recorded them so every one is exactly 1 minute long. So if it was like a long, elaborate story, he would talk fast as hell to make it exactly a minute. Or if it was a small story, he would put spaces in to always make every story exactly a minute. Anyway, what I have done, people, is I've taken a bunch of these stories and put them on a playlist on my Cage invented this little device called an iPhone. And so I put them on my John Cage iPhone on a playlist. And what you're about to see me do, or you, is I'm going to hit shuffle on the playlist. And the stories will come up randomly. Whichever story comes up, it'll come into my ear here through my John Cage earbud. And whichever Cage story comes up, I will speak it. But the stories are going to come in random order. I'm going to tell like four of these one-minute stories, exactly four of these one-minute stories. At the same time, I'm going to do a dance, which is not random or shuffled. I do the dance, the same moves every time. So since the stories are randomly shuffled, but the dance is fixed, the way the words match up with the movement is different every performance. So what you will see in the next 4 minutes will never be seen again. And if you enjoy it, in a year from now, pandemic permitting, I'm going to do all 90 of Cage's stories at La MaMa Theater on 4th Street. You've heard of it. We're going to do the Cage Marathon, all 90 stories. So the reason I'm blabbing is because I'm procrastinating, because it's difficult what I'm about to do, particularly the part where I have to get up, which I'm about to do now. Okay, here I go, people. I'm getting up now. Okay, I'm up. Woohoo! Okay, I'm up. Step one, get up. Now I gotta get my cage-o-phone out. See, here's all of his stories on a playlist. And now I'm gonna hit shuffle. Let me see if I got the volume up. I do, okay. Four years ago, I was talking with Hirokazu Yoshida. We were on the train from Donaueschingen to Köln. I mentioned the book by Herigel called Zen and the Art of Archery. The melodramatic climax of this book concerns an archer hitting the bullseye, though he did so in total darkness. Yoshida told me there's one thing the author failed to point out. That is, there lives in Japan at the present time a highly esteemed archer who's never yet been able to hit the bullseye, even in broad daylight. Two monks came to a stream. One was Hindu, the other Zen. The Hindu monk began to cross the stream,
by walking on the surface of the water. The Zen monk became excited and called to him, "Come back! What's the matter?" The Hindu monk said. The Zen monk said, "That's not the way to cross the stream. Follow me." He led him to a place where the water was shallow, and they waded across. Two wooden boxes containing Indian spices and foodstuff arrived from India. One was for David Tudor, the other for me. Each of us found on opening his box, the contents were all mixed up. The lids of plastic containers of spices had come off. Plastic bags of dried beans and palm sugar had ripped open. Tin lids of chili powder had come off. All these things were mixed together with the Excelsior, which had been put in the box to keep the containers in position. I put my box in a corner, simply tried to forget about it. David Tudor, on the other hand, set to work assembling bowls of various sizes, sieves of 11 size screens, a pair of tweezers and a small knife. He began a process which lasted 3 days, at the end of which time, each spice was separated from each other, each kind of bean from each other. The palm sugar lumps had been scraped free of spice. Excavations had removed embedded beans. And then he called me up to say, "Whenever you want to get at that box of spices you have, let me know. I'll help you." Woo! See, he does. He talks fast sometimes. I was never psychoanalyzed. I'll tell you how it happened. I was at a chip on my shoulder about psychoanalysis. I knew the remark of Rilke to a friend of his who wanted him to be psychoanalyzed. Rilke said, "I'm sure they'd remove my devils, but I fear they'd offend my angels." When I went to the analyst for a kind of preliminary meeting, he said, "I'll be able to fix you so you'll be able to write much more music than you do now." I said, "Good heavens, I already write too much, it seems to me. That promise has put me off." In the nick of time, Judith Sarabhai came from India. She was concerned about the influence Western music was having on traditional Indian music. She decided to study Western music for 6 months with several teachers and returned to India to do what she could to preserve Indian traditions. She studied contemporary music with me and said, "How much do you charge?" I said, "It'll be free if you'll teach me about Indian music." We were almost every day together. At the end of 6 months, just before she flew away, she gave me the Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna. It took me a year to finish reading it. Mattie, was that 3 stories or 4 that I just did? Huh?
That was 4. I had my mic muted.
Oh, 4. Oh, then I'm done. Woo!
Woo!
Thank you, people.
Wow.
Damn.
Damn. You got to talk fast.
I know. It's, that's the deal. You got to,
Got to. Oh, wait. Did you mute yourself?
Whoops.
Oh, I hear you. I hear you. It's good.
You can hear me?
I hear ya.
Oh, oops. Wait, I gotta turn off my cageophone. Okay.
Cageophone.
Hi.
Hi.
Jesus Christ. That's the first time I did that on camera in my house. It's funny performing in your house.
Yeah.
Because your house is like the place of ultimate calm and relaxation. And yet I'm having the ultimate opposite of that in that I'm performing. So this time of isolation or online.
Move your camera a little bit. When you put it there, your mic goes away a little.
Oh, how's it?
Wait, move it.
Up. Can you hear me?
Yeah, there you go. There you go.
That's good?
Yes.
Ooh, I look so horrible. Ooh.
No, you look.
No, I look beautiful.
Yeah,
everybody's beautiful on television.
Everybody looks beautiful on LiveLab.
Yes. So anyway,
yeah,
performing at home is a weird mix of performing anxiety. You know.
Yeah, so. I feel you. I know, and I had my roommates out here, and I was nervous about that. And they're still just sitting on the couch, and that's what we do. We just sit on the couch together.
Isn't that funny to bring all the intensity and anxiety of performing into your home?
Yeah. And this is a piece that you do perform in real spaces and in real venues. I mean, not that your home isn't a real space, but it's a...
Well, yeah, my space, I never, yeah, yes. I've performed this for a long time in front of actual humans that were near one another and near me.
Yeah.
Reckless as that may sound.
I know.
And performing it for the camera is, I'm learning. I'm learning.
What do you think about the framing? Because I don't know if you noticed, but Paul had actually flipped his laptop, so it was like sitting sideways. And I want to know, like, what did you feel about that, playing with that element?
I saw my own image, which of course in a live performance is the last thing in the world you want to do, but you have to get used to these things.
Yeah.
So I saw my own image and I was trying to keep that little picture of me inside that tiny little box.
Mm-hmm.
It's a funny little task, to keep that little Polly in the little boxy, you know, different, you know, a whole new set of challengerie. But I do want to, if I could,
please,
I could take this thing off my tongue.
Good.
And then say, once again, meet you all late March of next year, God willing, at La MaMa, where I'm going to do all 90 stories, all 90. And so that's going to require 90 minutes of movement.
Woo, baby.
Which is what I'm doing alone in my house these days, is making 90 minutes of movement.
That's like a whole movie.
Yeah, that's right.
God, that, what a good title. You must, you I don't want to say you lucked into that, because it's definitely, but Shuffle, Cage.
Cage Shuffle.
Dang.
I guess so Cage invented the Cageo phone.
Yeah.
You know, he was probably had my performance in mind, I suppose. Darn it, something was in my head, but I forget what it is, what it was.
Well,
that's
how it goes.
That's how it goes. Yeah. Yeah. Our memories are going to get shaky because we're not galvanized by being around one another live.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that's a painting behind me. That's a painting by Resnick, Milton Resnick, who's a friend of my father's. Great fucking painter. He lived what had previously been a synagogue on the Lower East Side. This is in the 40s and 50s.
Whoa.
Here, let me show you this painting. It's really fantastic. Let's see if I can. Oh, yeah, this is beyond my skills. Woo! Shit. It's beyond my skills, guys. But look them up. Google
him. Get it when you have all of us over for the after party in March.
Go in March when you come over.
Yeah.
Between now and then, go to Google Images and look up Milton Resnick.
Will do.
Great painter.
All right, Paul. In a little box.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you all. And goodbye and have a wonderful show.
Hey, thanks. Thanks for being a part of it.
My pleasure. It was really fun.
Yay.
Bye-bye.
Bye. All right. Paul Lazar live in person in his home through LiveLab to you. That's real. Okay. So next we are showing a piece of video art. But this is a little different than what we've been doing. We have been showing you short pieces, three separate pieces that maybe go together, maybe don't. But this week we're showing you one long piece split in two. So this is Mengwen Cao, who is an artist that we met through the Magnum Foundation in ReFest last year in 2019. And this video is called Here We Are. And again, it's not normally played in these two separate chunks, but Meng said that they were down to let us experiment and see if that would work. So we'll have the second half of the video later, and Meng is also going to join us at that time live. So here we are.
My name is Mengwen Cao. I am 27. I grew up in China and now I live in New York. This is me when I was younger. These are my parents. My parents thought I had never been in love. We didn't talk about relationships because I had a secret. I like girls. I'm their only child. Every time they asked me about marriage or grandchildren, it would make me nervous. As time went on, I wanted to find a way to tell them and decided to create a video letter coming out to them. I shared it with them as we talked on FaceTime. The video letter they will be watching will be previewed next to me as they react on the main screen.
Okay.
爸妈, 我出国已经三年了。这三年我从各方面改变都很大。 从22岁到25岁, 似乎是我迟到了的青春期。 暴力成长，朝着内心的声音走。和你们的关系也越来越从父母儿女走向朋友。没有你们长久以来对我无条件的支持，就没有今天的我。尽管我总是在这方面寡言，但我对你们的爱和感激是满满的。你们总是温柔地抱怨我和你们的沟通不够，因为我不太喜欢汇报自己的生活。 也因为我有一个穿插在生活各个角落的秘密，但它像一堵隐形的墙，阻止了我们互相走近的步伐。是时候拆掉这堵墙了。爸爸妈妈，我喜欢女生。我从小时候就开始喜欢女生了。六年级的时候很喜欢一个人，他正好是女生。我很困惑也很压抑，做了一个梦，在井边我和自己说。 我谁也不告诉。但那之后，我意识到我喜欢一个人是因为这个人，性别并不是判断标准，是男是女是跨性别都没有关系。我知道这不是主流，但这也不是不正常。不知道你们看到这里是什么感觉？不解、担忧。我希望你们不要担心，这对我来说会是最大的安慰和支持。 因为这并没有改变我是谁，我依然是爱你们的女儿，我依然和大家一样为自己的生活奋斗，我依然有志同道合的朋友，依然有指导我前行的老师。尽管现在是单身，但我也认真的谈过恋爱，爱过，被爱过。我对周围的人很公开，从未因此受到过歧视，遇到了很多同志朋友。 他们活得公开、自由，虽然也迷茫过、挣扎过，他们的家人也许曾经不理解、不接受，但只要能够好好的沟通，这都会过去的。非常庆幸你们对 LGBTQ 群体整体的包容。我记得当年爸爸推荐我看《断背山》，看到最后衬衫叠衬衫的一幕，我哭得泣不成声。你也是，我也记得妈妈。 会提到接的团里的同性情侣，是音乐家，在一起多年，人很好。我去拍 Pride Parade 分享照片后，你们留言说爱你自己，做你自己。但我也知道，这和要接受自己的女儿也是其中的一员，不太一样。有好几次和你们坦白的机会，比如今年夏天我们一起看《奇葩说》，刚好看到一期辩题是。 该不该向父母出柜？我紧张的心都跳到喉咙口了。但那期节目让我看到了希望，没人批判同志，选择不同立场的人给的理由也多是建立于社会环境。但开放宽容的社会环境，需要更多的人站出来，需要更多的讨论。我想成为其中的一员，我那时无法用言语表达内心的复杂情绪。 也许是因为出柜意味着主动选择一个阵营，一个相对弱势、非主流的阵营。但我不想逃避了，我觉得这也是选择了一种力量。如果你们能够站在我的身边，我会非常高兴。 这也许来得太过突然，你们需要时间消化。没关系，这只是一个开始，起码我们能够更加坦诚的交流，你们也会了解一个更加真实的我。相信最后 Love wins。 爱你们的女儿，文文。
更给你持久器械保护。
啊，文文，
嗯，
我也实话实说啊，这件事情呢，爸爸妈妈其实之前有过怀疑。其实是担心，就是如果说别人我都能够接受，那我就直说啊。但是女儿呢，总是觉得好像啊，最好不是这样。所以呢，我是想说，你到底是对这个事情感兴趣呢？那种，
就是担心，但是我们。其实说实话，这个心理准备也还是有的，虽然不希望是事实，但是心理准备是有的。
啊，那么现在你跟我们说呢，那我们也觉得完全是能够理解啊，那完全能够理解。所以呢，是从我们自身来讲呢，我们可以We can take it. We can accept it. 但是
还是希望
啊，实际上还是希望，就是说总是一种或者说是 conventional 吧，我用这个词好了，不用 traditional, conventional 的那个 idea, 或者说那个 concept 比较容易
就是如果将来有可能，就是你看到一个你喜欢的男生，那我们就是心里还是很希望，就是将来有这样的可能性。
Yeah. All right, so I made that whole to-do about us doing half of the video first and half of the video later, but that was the whole thing. We put the different one in. So now Meng is actually going to join us now to talk. Hey, Meng.
Hey.
So it was meant to be, right?
I guess we still played the whole
video. I know, we didn't mean to, but I think it's all right. Hey, how are you?
Yeah, I'm good. It's kind of interesting to watch myself
mm-hmm.
coming out with my parents.
Totally.
And just, yeah, it's a really weird experience.
Right. I have your little video in my little box while I'm watching your box of videos with two little boxes.
Yeah, I think it's my first time to see so many layers of myself in different mm-hmm. timelines laid out in this way. And also it's a pretty intense moment, I guess. It was 4 years ago. And then seeing myself back then and seeing my parents, yeah, it's I guess that's a digital only experience.
Totally. So much has changed. And when you initially made this piece, it feels like so hard to want to first of all have the foresight to say, okay, I want to record this moment, even though it's going to be one of the most private and potentially most difficult moments of my life, and then to say, okay, I want to share this with the world. What moved you to do that?
I think I always have a tendency to do a lot of self-archiving. Mm-hmm. As a photographer, I always love to observe life, and I find a lot of beauty in daily life, good and bad, bright and dark. So I always like to archive things. And when I made that project, I was also just scared. Yeah. I was not really prepared to talk to them directly because it was still pretty hard to talk about coming out in China. And my parents are back in China at that time. I was studying in New York. So it was kind of, it was not an option. FaceTime for us was the way to communicate. And I thought this would be a once in a lifetime moment. And before I did this, I was doing a lot of research online. Research, meaning binge watching a lot of coming out videos on YouTube. And most of the videos I watched are not relatable, not super right. relatable for me. I really see Asian people coming out in a public way. And I look back, I think I do applaud myself. I think I appreciate it now more than at that time. At that time, because I originally started it really as a personal project, I didn't expect it to go far out to the public in this way. Mm-hmm. So I think for me, it was a really precious moment I want to treasure. And I also wanted to share more raw and nuanced and authentic representation of who we are. It's mm-hmm. not always clean, it's not always beautiful, but it's real. So I decided to share that with the world.
Yeah, so, I mean, I'm so emotional just in the beginning of it. I was watching it a few days ago, and then I got a video call from my mom and my brother. And I was like, just getting ready to like welcome the cry. And then they called and I was like, oh, hey, I was just getting ready to just, but then there's that moment of the fact that most of my communication, most of my talking to loved ones is happening through the phone because it has to right now. And even more moments, you know, I feel like maybe there's a little bit of a novelty of like coming out on FaceTime when you did this piece. And now it's the novelty sort of worn off. That's sort of our only choice for difficult events, celebratory events, weddings, funerals. And we were sort of talking about like the layers to all of this too.
I think it's a moment for us to like really think about how actually we are one. We are connected with everyone if we want to. But I think a lot of times back then, like for me, even now, talking to my parents with the internet becomes so second nature. Mm-hmm. But I think a lot of times, like for a lot of people now, like they are experiencing it the first time. So I really appreciate this moment in a weird way that we suddenly are forced to experience this dilemma of communication, human connection through this weird boundary. And I was watching the performers before, they were talking about like now they have to be confined in this little grid to perform a live show that was planned. I think it's interesting. I think that like, at least for me, really it caused me to be even more real, more authentic with myself, because I think even when I go to Zoom meetings, I know I still can read the room of the yeah. Zoom meeting, like although we don't physically see each other. So I think if we really connects with our heart, with the screen, we can still reach that level of connection. So yeah, I think that's something really special at this moment.
Yes, I love thinking about it, the shared dilemma of human connection and communication. Like, now we all have to actually figure it out. We don't get to just say, oh, but I'll see you or whatever. That's cool.
Yeah. So
wow. And you've swept in at the last moment to come and join us live today. So thank you so much. I hope we keep coming together.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me. This is such a great event and fun experimentation for all of us.
Yes. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I'll keep watching. Also, great look today.
Okay, I guess that's a natural segue. Sungmin, full screen, please. So tonight, thank you, Mengwen, for the segue. This, you might notice I look a little, how do you say, better than usual? And that is thanks to a certain best friend of mine named Verna Estes, who has created everything I'm wearing from the waist up, including these tights as sleeves, this, oh wait, here it is, champion shirt puff sleeves, and this bodice, and this fancy, fancy clip-on earrings that happen to say my initials. So that's that. That's Verna Estes. She's my best friend. Now, Todd Anderson has been hanging out in this room, and I think we're about ready to go to Todd. I'm about to tell you what's going to happen, and then Todd's going to tell you what's going to happen, and then it's going to happen. So Todd Anderson is our Culture Hub's resident artist currently, and he has a performance group called H0t Club. Totally, this is the variety show. This is going to be totally something new, something totally different from what you just saw. He is going to take us into Mozilla Hubs, which is like this virtual world, and tell us a little audiovisual story with three fine collaborators of his. So Todd, join me.
Yeah.
Hello.
Hi, Mattie. How's it going?
Good. How are you?
I'm doing well. Excited to be here with you in virtual space.
Mm-hmm. So tell us what you've been doing.
Well, I'm like we've all been in our own separate spaces for a little while now. And H0t Club, really, since we've been just spending all our time on our computers, we really just kind of missed our things, you know? And so we just decided to make a space online where we could hang out with all our things together in a world. So we found our own little corner of the Internet of Things and built a little secret lair inside of Mozilla Hubs. And we're going to give you a little tour of our secret lair.
Sounds fabulous. What is H0t Club?
So H0t Club is a multimedia performance group. It is a band. It is a lifestyle, perhaps a lifestyle brand. We're a collaborative group of four people. We have two composers, one of whom is a percussionist, one of whom is more of an audiovisual creator. We have a theater director, and then we have me, a writer slash technologist, and we just make experimental types of performances that kind of make strange, different sort of performance environments. We really like to kind of like blur the lines of the stage and have lots of fun technology going on when we're in physical spaces. And Mozilla Hubs here allows us to kind of play with that physical metaphor and kind of just play around in space a little more. So it's been a good environment for our group.
Beautiful. All right, go blur the stage.
All right, I'm gonna make myself small real quick. Here we go.
Oh, my favorite thing. Thank you.
Okay, great. Here I am. So hey, welcome everyone. Welcome to our clubhouse, our secret lair. Oh no, our video stopped playing. I wonder if I can get that playing again. Here's some photos of H0t Club. Here we are. This is our secret clubhouse here. some photos of shows, kind of a little band and theater vibe. Here's our pet fish, Mondo. He's a big fellow. We're awful fond of him. Let's keep going into the main room here. We got a little show documentation here. Oh, it's a nice guitar solo there. Very nice. I like that. Who's this in the main room? It's Mary Catherine Goddard, the only woman who signed the Declaration of Independence. Mary Catherine Goddard, what are you doing here in the Hot Club secret lair?
Oh, what's up, Todd? Hey, it's me. I'm Mary Catherine Goddard, and I'm so excited to be here hanging with you guys. You might know me as the only woman in the Declaration of Independence, but I also ran a printing press for many years. And so, yeah, I'm like in search of some things, you know, on the net. Because in my day, we had to like print words on paper and words used to be things. But nowadays on the internet, words just seem to be meaningless. So when I heard Hot Club was making things on the internet, I had to see what you were talking about. I find things to be so freeing. You know, don't tread on my things, Todd.
Oh, yeah. You get it, Mary Catherine Goddard. Like, we in Hot Club, we just believe that everything has a right to be things. And that all things deserve to be with each other. And we, as Hot Club, deserve to be with our things. And I'm so glad you get it. You seem real rad, Mary Catherine Goddard. I love talking about things with you.
Same, Todd. So cool. I love that you guys, you know, make technology playful, accessible, and you create this layer of objects and internet of things. Cool, bro. Here's the thing, though. My sweet neighborhood boy, Doug Mitchens, back from the 1800s, seems to be opening up a new set of things right now. Wait, do you know Doug?
You know Doug Mitchens? Doug Mitchens is our new intern. He just started yesterday. Let's go see what he's up to.
Oh.
Whoa. Hey, Doug. What you got there?
What's up, Doug?
Doug.
Oh, yo, what's up, guys? I just got this box in the mail here, so I'm going to do a little unboxing, you know?
Oh, nice.
Yeah, so let's just start it up. Yo, this is Doug the intern, and this is another unboxing of one of the loot boxes we get in weekly. So this week, whoa. I don't know, it's feeling a little light. But you know, we'll check it out anyways. So first item that we have up, this is it's a CBD oil. That's pretty rad.
Be careful with that at work here, Doug.
Nah, dude, it's chill. Like CBD oil, it's just gonna, you know, help you focus and pay attention to stuff. So I think it's gonna be pretty rad.
Okay, cool.
I trust you. Bubble wrap.
Yeah, that's a great thing.
Yeah. Is this like maybe an instruction manual? Let's see.
Oh my god, you guys, that is the real Declaration of Independence.
Dun, dun, dun.
That is a historic relic, man. That is a thing that is so pure, it cannot be copied. It cannot be copied online. God knows I've tried.
Ow,
yeah, I mean, okay, if it's real, I mean, this seems pretty important. Maybe I should put it somewhere safe.
Totally. Back in the National Archive.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, I'm just going to upload it to the cloud real quick. Hold on.
No, don't do it.
No!
Yeah, dude, what? It's up there.
No. If you upload it to the cloud, it'll disappear from the real world.
Nah, dude, check it out. It's right here. Right here.
No, yeah. Doug Mitchens, put that back.
Put that back now.
That peen just stole the Declaration of Independence. If we don't return that to the real world, the colonies will return to the British.
I'll come to Utah. Go get
them. Oh, wow. General George Washington, Captain of the Washington Generals. Did you see a teen coming through here with the Declaration of Independence?
Oh, I did indeed see that scallywag. He escaped up towards the great basketball court in the cloud.
The great court in the cloud? Oh, we'll never get there.
Fear not. Just look to the sky and find your personal freedom. And remember, Todd, the greater the conflict, the greater the triumph. Let's fly.
The greater the conflict, the greater the triumph. Oh! Wow. George Washington, I didn't know you could fly.
Oh, there are many surprises out here. Now come on, let's go dunk on that intern.
Let's go.
This is the hall of the founding daddies. Come on, everyone, keep going.
There he is. He's playing with the Declaration of Independence right by the permanent digitization portal. If it goes through that, we can never return it to the real world. Don't do it, Doug Mitchens.
Do it, Doug.
Give me back that declaration.
Shoot a three-pointer with this? What do you think?
No, don't do it. Oh, I got it. I got to dunk this back into the real world.
No way, Todd.
That's mine. Give it back.
Oh, General Washington, why would you stop me?
Stand and ball, coward.
Oh.
Watch out, I got him.
Oh, Mary Catherine Goddard, save me. Oh, yes. That's right. This has made me realize independence wasn't enough. We need more, a declaration of interdependence. And as I slam it through this hoop into the real world, that's what we'll have. Here we go. Oh, it's returned. It's safe. It's in back in the National Archive, and I don't know if you can read the fine print, but it says that in addition to having all our freedoms and stuff, we also have to rely on each other and treat each other well and support each other, especially in difficult times. I know the print is very small, but I promise you that's what it says. Okay, that's the end of our little show for you. I'm just gonna hop back into our hub real quick, introduce. I have a little curtain call with the cast and crew. Let me hop back in here, teleport over to another part of our world. Hey, so yeah, I'd just like to introduce you two. We have Kate Bergstrom as Mary Catherine Goddard. Hey, Kate. And we have, We have Alexander Dupuis as General George Washington. Oh, yeah.
Hello.
Looking fresh, Alex. And where is that scoundrel? Oh, here he is. As teenage intern Doug Mitchens, we have Martim Galvo. Hey, Martim.
Yeah. What up, everyone?
Yeah. So, yeah, we're Hot Club. Stay home, stay safe. Here's where you can find us. And here's our new digital home. We'll maybe hang out with you here again sometime. Okay. That's all I got.
Keep tracking us. We'll share our little GitHub with you too. You can come visit our gallery.
Yeah.
Applause, Todd.
Oh, applause. Yeah.
There we go.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Wonderful. Well.
I'll make myself big again.
So, that's Hot Club in Mozilla Hubs with Todd Anderson, teeny tiny in the corner. Normally, Todd Anderson, teeny tiny in the corner, wouldn't be appearing when they are collaborating together, but we asked him to appear teeny tiny in the corner so that we could feel connected to what was going on in you know, a more human way. So thank you, Todd, for appearing teeny tiny and all of Hot Club. So if you're joining us or just popping in for this exact moment, I'm Mattie BB, Mattie Barber-Bockelman, and this is Downtown Variety Take 8. We've been at this for 8 damn weeks. And artists, as you can see and will see, are finding creative ways to collaborate, which is, of course, a function of this time. We're all forced online in some ways. But it's also work that we've been exploring for the past 10 years with CultureHub. And something that I think Billy was saying earlier was like, oh shit, now the future is happening. Kind of happened a little too fast, but here we all are. And I also just wanted to let you know that everyone that you, while you personally can't see everyone who is watching with you, this is a really cool audience. I just want to let you know, like, very cool. Like, people who, if you were in the same physical space with, you'd be like, oh, hey, how are you? It's been so long. Or, oh, damn, I love your jacket. That's so cool. Where'd you get it? I want one like that. Or, oh, hey, wasn't that that shirtless guy from the show a couple weeks ago? So, yeah, our audience is kind of hot. So, as are our next performers, Dan Safer and Abigail Browde. So they are up next.
Those two. You feeling good, Dan? Your name's Dan, right? Not Maurice. Dan. And this was your idea, right? Your idea to do this show, right? And you asked me to come do it? You upset about that? You regretting that you asked me to do this with you? You're feeling pleased. You're feeling excited to be here. You're feeling pleased. You're feeling good. Your right arm's feeling really nice and warm. You're not tired at all. Good. Are you shy, Dan? You a shy person? Are you embarrassed about doing this? You're not embarrassed to do this on the internet? You think there are some people watching? I think there are a few people watching. You think your mom is watching? Because you didn't invite her, did you? You like doing shows for your mom?
I didn't hear you.
You can't hear me? Can you hear me? Can you hear me, Dan? Is technology amazing? Is it incredible that we can do this? Are you feeling tired? What does it take, Dan? How's your right leg? Is your right leg feeling good? You're feeling a little tired? Are you thinking about the time and how long it's been? Don't look at the time, Dan. Are you all alone? There's no one else in your house? Are you alone? You've got someone there. And you said I could ask you anything I wanted. Did you give me any limitations? You say I could ask you anything? We said we weren't going to talk about certain things, didn't we? There were things we aren't going to cover. We'll keep those a secret, right? Just you and me and the internet audience. Is your left leg moving? Aren't you supposed to be using your right leg? Have you got boundless energy? You want to keep going? You want to stop? Is the sun shining? Sun shining where you are? No, it's snowing, isn't it? It's snowing outside. You excited about that snow? You're really looking forward to a winter wonderland. Are the cats in there with you, Dan? Are they watching you dance? The cats. Is there someone else in the house with you, Dan? Someone else is there, right? We're not going to talk about that, are we?
Whew.
Thank you, Abigail and Dan. How's the horn?
Oh, there they are.
Oh, the horn was perfect. Thank you for the disco horn.
Because it definitely didn't go off before when I was muted and freak everybody else out. No, it didn't. It didn't.
It was very good. How long was that? 5 minutes?
Five whole damn minutes.
Wow. It's a workout.
I know. I mean, Abby, how are you feeling after asking all those questions?
Really,
it's brutal for you.
Ready for my cocktail.
I know. Like, just so many words.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's a lot.
So much for you.
Yeah. You're she's a trooper.
The only question I have is, what were the things you agreed not to talk about?
We're not going to talk about things.
But that was during the 5 minutes.
Yeah.
So, Dan, how'd you come up with this piece?
This was, I've been doing versions of this for a while. I think it came out, it's either stolen directly from or very influenced by work I was doing with Ishmael Houston Jones. And we made a duet together 7 or so years ago. And I think there was something very similar to this that was one of Ish's scores that we did in that. And then I kind of took it and messed with it. But it's definitely a direct descendant or like a nosy neighbor of Ish's stuff.
I like that.
Yeah.
And if you're wondering if you got it, yes, Abby was asking questions that had yes or no answers mostly. And Dan was modulating his speed based on the answer to those questions, correct?
Yeah. Faster is, yes is faster, no is slower.
Mm-hmm.
And
what's the story with you and Abby?
Abby and I, well, we're sort of related.
Excuse me?
Abby, do you want to explain it?
Well, I think it's that my, this, we learned this like after we already knew each other, but my sister's brother-in-law, my sister's husband's brother, his wife.
Whoa.
Dan's first cousin.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
So we're some kind of, I think the word in Yiddish is mishpucha, but.
And then Abby's mom works with.
Dad,
you're, oh, right.
My dad was a colleague, a close colleague of your dad's college roommate's wife.
Yes.
It's like you guys are being tested on this.
Yeah. But it's very tenuous, but it's all real things.
Yeah.
And then Abby and I, Abby used to be one of the main performers in Witness Relocation many years ago. Not so many years ago,
not
but
that many.
In like downtown theater world a little while ago.
And something I loved that
Abby was in my, the first Witness Relocation show that was at La Mama, Abby was in.
Gorgeous. Yeah. And something Abby said earlier, which I loved, when we were having some, I don't know if they were technical difficulties or technical quirks, is, hey, we might be online, but we're still downtown.
Yeah.
Hence the name, Downtown Variety.
Yeah.
And you guys are both in the Catskills right now, not too far from one another. Ain't it the truth?
That's true. We're like 15 minutes away from each other by car.
So if you really needed to look at each other's real faces through a real.
We actually, we could have done this with social distancing. We're just too lazy.
Gorgeous.
Yeah.
Got to stay true to who we are in some ways.
Yeah, we could have done it. I mean, like, yeah, we could have. I was saying earlier that I could have tried to, like, if the cell phone reception was good, I could have tried to drive over to Abby's house for this conversation after the performance.
Nice.
Yeah.
All right, y'all.
Yeah. All right.
Great.
Hey, wait, one more question. Dan, do you have anything that you need to ask Abby, yes or no only?
Oh, geez.
Ooh.
You have 10.
Careful. What don't you know?
What don't I know? Do you have any good greens left from the Asian market in Albany?
No, everything's gone. It's very
okay. Thank you, everybody.
Thanks for joining us.
Okay. Bye.
Feel better, Dan. Feel better. All right. Our last performance for the night is coming up just around the corner. We've got John Maria Gutierrez joining us, who will be joining us for the third time, which you may be able to tell from his facial hair or the developing concepts in this third installment in his isolation series. So I'm just gonna make sure that John is ready. John, give me a thumbs up if you're muted. Gorgeous, all right. Everybody, isolation series number 3 by John Maria Gutierrez.
Thank you. Thank you.
John Gutierrez.
Hello.
John.
What's up?
Hey.
Hi.
Back again, are you?
Back again. Ah. Technology.
I know, right? Oh.
Okay. Doesn't always work.
There we go. Curtains.
The way you want it.
Theater curtains, you know?
Yeah.
What's up, John?
What's up? You know, trying to, I don't know, so many things. So many things are up and down.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like I've been down a little bit past couple weeks.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so just trying to figure out how to deal with that.
Yeah. Yeah, I feel like last week, every day was waking up in a state of disbelief, just like, seriously, still? This is it?
Yeah.
It's like an immediate.
I think that the first one I did of these, it was this like, oh, you know, a month and a half. And then I when it got to the point where you realize it's going to last a lot longer and that there is no knowing about how much longer. And I think for me, it started feeling a little bit like what limbo must feel like.
Mm-hmm.
The idea of we have all these memories of the past and normal this thing or what it used to be like. And then we have a very clear now. And then no one has any idea of what happens next.
Yeah.
And so I don't know what to prepare for. I don't know what I should be doing. And I don't want to be needing to do anything. I just want to be okay right now. And I've, you know, it's like I've had some relatives pass and friends who've had it. And so I think I can't plan for how those things are going to manifest inside of me. And yeah, it just feels like everything's turned upside down, literally. And so wanted to bring some of that to this a little.
Yeah, and you had messages.
Yeah.
Written on your body. I want to go through those. So the first one was hello.
Hello.
Hello. This is also kind of giving me throwbacks to this is his
face. Exactly. my cousin taught me one in Spanish. If you write queso, which means cheese on your hand, you can say, ¿qué es eso? Eso es queso. What is this? This is cheese. And so I was, I mean, I've been thinking about family and that came up, that came back. And I feel like there's a kind of childishness and being, I've never been home this long, I think, as an adult person. And I've just been thinking a lot about like the past. And so it came out of that. And then also like this, on this platform too, I haven't really played with. I've had music doing the kind of work for me in that way. And I've been listening to a lot of Aaron Copland, who's a New York native. And I recently moved to Brooklyn and just trying to figure out what Brooklyn is about, being from Manhattan myself. And I've really been thinking about the past and other American artists, how they might be dealing with this time if they were still around, these sort of like widely accepted American artists.
Right.
And this this song is by Aaron Copland. It's called Letter from Home. And he wrote this many, many years ago. And I thought like, what I really wish is that I could see everyone I miss right now. And not just like on FaceTime. I think that there's a way, it's like there's a kind of missing that's happening that isn't about what we have to say or, you know, an email or a text or something. And I think also watching a lot of the downtown varieties and thinking about technology, what the technology attempts to do for us as performers right now, as creators, how do we connect to each other? And I was like, I want it to be a little messy. I want it to be on my body.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
I mean, I was on the FaceTime with my mom earlier, and I want to touch her cheek, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
Such soft cheeks. And It's just that. That's it. Yeah. Please.
Life doesn't work on a 2D platform. And so I think also like changing the different angles and shapes that can be created using this tool, this computer. And also like we can't be I feel like we're not as careful with people. We like hug people and sort of shake them a little bit and all these things. But then these tools are expensive and delicate. And and so I also like there's like Sharpie marks all over my computer now. And I'm happy with that. I'm like, it's like this is communication isn't straightforward or clean. And
it's a collaborator in this moment.
Yeah, and especially this moment, I think that whether or not you agree or disagree with the technology or like how we used it before, I think now because it's the only thing we have, all sorts of people are using it. Also sorts of people who aren't typically engaging with the material.
Yeah.
And I'm like, shout out, you know, it's like, I think I have family members watching who've never come to see me perform in a theater before, but this is also allows them a kind of
new possibilities
to see me and to see me do something.
I have family in Ohio watching now too.
Ohio. But yeah, so there's like there's hello,
yeah,
there's I miss you, miss you, I miss touch, on my back, which is like, it says, so after the little letter, this is like the PS to the letter is on my back.
The world?
The world is turned upside down.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And then on my foot is a list of things that I
miss. Barbecue.
Yeah. First off, that was like a major, major craving.
Yeah.
2 weeks ago, it just like hit me. And like Kim was really nice and we ordered some bar. Like we've been cooking all our meals at home and we forgot that you can like order out or go pick up.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so we were like, oh yeah, you can do that. And so we did that, but, it's yeah. Barbecue, being away.
Yeah.
Yeah. Familiar faces, like it's strange, like what you miss is what you see every day.
Mm-hmm.
I don't necessarily miss the special things you do, but just like the people I talk to all the time and the things that I do all the time.
Yeah.
And then also getting lost, I feel
randomness is what I miss.
Yeah.
It's just like whatever. I miss whatever.
Exactly, like running into a stranger, you know, like meeting someone new and
something unexpected. But I think, I don't know, there's unexpected things that are happening here. I wasn't expecting to see the views of windows, unfamiliar windows.
Yeah. So that was like, I also, you know, I think performing at La Mama so much and with the great Jones over the past 2 years, I'm super grateful that I was able to perform with Panorama. And it was like every other month we were in a completely different country, landscape, language, whatever. And now I look out my window sometimes and it literally like my imagination started going and like creating different vistas.
Yeah.
And so I asked a couple of people who I miss, some friends who I haven't seen in a long time, but have reconnected through this time or whatever it is. Or if like, what do you look at when you look out the window? Cause we all look out the window, but what we see out there is very different. And we're all like doing this, but what we experience is we're all like experiencing this thing in different ways.
Yeah.
So I really wanted to connect to people. I think that there's been like a storm of emotions and ups and downs that I've been feeling over the past couple of weeks, and I like don't have the words for them all the time. And I think people have been really helpful, and I wanted them to be part of this piece too. I think a lot of this series has been about how can I bring that thing that I miss about someone else here to me.
Right.
And even editing all these different videos and looking at kind of the response people are giving me has really helped me like just connect with the fact that like, all right, we are, I can't see you, but we are in this together. And it's like, yeah. I can't wait to go to Hawaii. That was one of the windows, because I've never been.
One day. And, you know, we're just, feels like it's just you and me talking right here, but there are people blowing up the comments too. Oh, man.
So, I forgot.
I know. Well, John, it's lovely to see you and have you developing work in this way and seeing new stuff from you that is complex and fraught in this time and beautiful and also, yeah, just wildly creative. So.
Yeah, I really appreciate that. And I appreciate all the work that you do, you specifically, and Culture Hub as well, and the MaMa. I think that this is giving me a platform to create. Like, I think more than an actor, or a dancer, or a performer, I think the ability to create and having the platform to do that is very important.
Yeah.
And especially for, because it's such a unique thing. It's such a specific thing. And thank you for allowing that.
Hey, thank you. All right, John. See you before long.
Bye.
Ciao. All right, y'all. That's it. That's our show. And we've been at it for 8 weeks, which is kind of crazy. We started this program on March 20th. And 1 week before that, we were in the downstairs at La Mama with ReFest. And we had gone online only with our festival, turning it into a broadcast show overnight. And 1 week later, we took this new leap headed towards a new unknown. That was Downtown Variety. And since then, we've worked with over 75 artists. And that's crazy. And we're going to continue to go there with new artists, with returning artists, and with you. And it's so good to have you here. But next week, we will not be having Downtown Variety. We have a different program going on called Experiments in Digital Storytelling. And we're going to have that on Saturday. So this is our first, that next week will be our first Friday without Downtown Variety, which I'm honestly scared of because I've had it every week since this has started. So I hope you'll join us on other experiments. We're also going to be going every other week with Downtown Variety in the future because we need more time to get LiveLab out to you. LiveLab, which is the platform we're using to connect with all these artists, is something that we're working on releasing to the public so artists and organizations can use it independently. So yeah, we're gonna be working our butts off to get that out to you in June. So next weekend we'll be live with Experiments in Digital Storytelling with Double I Studios on the 16th. Before that, tomorrow we're live with Hunter College Dance with Maura Donahue. And Sunday, our very own Sungmin Che is presenting his thesis, which is a collaboration with Bear Opera. So it has been an absolute pleasure to host Downtown Variety and connect with you every week and meet all these damn creative people. I hope you've enjoyed it too. And I just want to say that it's always a pleasure to work with this team that's producing Downtown Variety, incredibly flexible, warm-hearted, multi-talented teams, especially the folks who are making the magic happen right now behind the scenes, Deandra Anthony, Sungmin Che, Jean Garcia. So thank you. I'm Mattie Barber-Bockelman. This is Downtown Variety, presented by La MaMa and Culture Hub. We will see you on May 22nd. Thank you.